Here we are discussing in the module number 5. So we have seen till now the properties of various materials and application of those materials in the engineering field. And we have also seen how to evaluate the properties, how to control them during the processing. Now, we need to evaluate the life of a component. So even while designing a component, we are going to estimate the life of that component depending on or considering the standard operating procedures. Say for example, if it is a vehicle, so we are going to design that life of that vehicle depending upon the speed at which we are going to drive, the road condition on which we are going to drive, and the maintenance, periodic maintenance which we are going to have it for that vehicle. So considering all these conditions with the standard operating procedure, we are going to estimate the life of a component. But when we are going to use those components in a real application, the conditions what we had assumed and the conditions which we are going to face in the reality are totally different. Sometimes the material which we have chosen might be a ductile one, but when we are going to use that one in the reality, due to the climatic changes or the environmental effects, the properties may change or it may transit from a ductile to the brittle, and it leads to the catastrophic failure, even a huge loss in terms of a money, in terms of a human life. So even when the component is in a use, so there are a standard procedures are methods by which we can evaluate the remaining life of a component. By knowing that one, we can avoid the failure of a component or the cost which incurred for over maintenance. So generally, whenever we are going to use that one, so we are going to say, see, a vehicle must be serviced for 5000 kilometers or 1 year. So whichever is earlier, you can do that like that. So if you are not going to maintain that one properly, okay, so if everything goes well, okay, say whenever you are going to purchase any electronic component, they say like there is a warranty for a 1 year. It may come maybe more than a year, but the manufacturer says it is for a 1 year. So if it comes for more than 1 year, then it is an advantage. So if it fails within an year again, so there may be some changes in the operating conditions. So that is what we are going to study in this section. Okay, so that method by which we are going to evaluate the remaining life of a component which is in service. So that is what we call as a residual life assessment. Residual, the remaining life of a component. Okay, so life assessment, the remaining life will be assessed by a method, okay, or by following few steps. By knowing this one, so we can avoid the failure of a component in service, or we can take a precautionary measures in order to replace any of the components in that machine or any device. And the techniques which we are going to utilize or adapt in order to evaluate or in order to assess the life of a component, it is something like not disturbing the process or not destructing the component. Say for example, I am using a machine, say like a lathe. I want to evaluate or assess the remaining life of this lathe. Say I am using this one from the last 10 years. I want to know like how many years I can use this one. So at that time I can't take a part from the lathe and subject that one for a destructive testing. Okay, there should be some technique by which you can evaluate the properties of the components which are involved in constructing that machine without destructing the things or without disturbing the operation of that machine. Okay, those techniques we are going to call as a non-destructive testing procedures. Means you are not going to deform, you are not going to what you call break that whatever the components into two pieces, or you are not going to create or damage any of the surface of that one. Okay, so that is what, as the name itself indicates, it's a we are going to have a non-destructive testing methods in order to assess the residual life. So even when we are going to follow this residual life assessment, okay, so there are few steps you need to follow. Okay, so there is a proper methodology, and by knowing this one, so one can easily predict, yes, after these many years, so the functioning of this machine or component will not be effective, will not be cost effective. So I need to replace that one. So in this regard, so we can say, so RLA in a short form, we are going to call this one as a RLA, residual life assessment. Okay, so it is done for a components like a aircraft, okay, or a boiler, or a components which are subjected to fatigue, okay, or a creep. Okay, and as I said, why these things? Say for example, if it is a boiler, okay, so boiler is designed for a particular pressure. Okay, so if the component is not in a position to withstand that much of pressure, there may be explosion, okay, which leads to a hazardous condition, okay, or a catastrophic failure and a huge loss. Okay, and the components which we are going to use at a high temperature. Okay, so all those things. So in a frequent manner, okay, after a particular period of time, so it is recommended to assess the residual life, so in order to minimize the loss, like a turbines. Okay, so now when you see here, so what are the methods or steps which are involved in this residual life assessment? Okay, very important thing. So first one is collection of background information. Okay, means there should be a system in place in every organization which uses a collection and a storage and manipulation of data associated with the operating history of the component. Okay, so if there is a proper maintenance and all. Okay, so inspection, failure analysis, life assessment, resources of all components. Okay, are the components which are having a critical functioning procedures. So we need to have a proper data. Okay, say for example, we will see the history. Okay, so maybe 1 year, 2 year back, so what are all the things have happened, what are the components which are replaced, okay, which are replenished, okay, which have undergone the service. So first thing is collection of the background information. The second step is material data. Okay, so by collecting these material data, like I say, for example, list of a critical components and their drawings. So example, we say turbine blades, rotors, casings, valves, fasteners. See, I can say like, see, when we have used a bolt and nut to join two components, so more than the components, the bolt and nut plays an important role. First and foremost thing is to check the functioning of that one, okay, or the capacity of that bolt and nut. So like that, the critical components. So material details of all the critical components and their test certificates, including NDT records. Okay, so before using those things, whether they have undergone any inspections, any quality checks, so all those things need to be checked. Next thing is FEM analysis data, if available. So for example, if you are designing a turbine, so before bringing that one to the reality, so it was designed and the design should be subjected to an analysis. Okay, so where under the operating conditions, how that component has performed. Okay, so that is what. So before having a prototype model, before bringing that one to the reality, okay, so whether it is analyzed for practical conditions by applying the limited conditions and all. So that is what exactly FEM means, finite element method. So thermodynamic cycle, strength design data, stress distribution in various critical components as anticipated during a design stage. Okay, see, when we are going to design a thing, so we are going to keep in mind, say for example, if it is a truck, so we are going to design that one to keep in mind like, yes, this is going to have a 100 tons of load. Okay, so when under the FEM, if you are going to apply a 100 ton, so we need to see what are the extreme conditions, okay, or the behavior of the components which are involved in the designing of a truck. Okay, so like that. So all the data pertaining to their materials, okay, and the FEM analysis and the design components and the drawing and the stress concentration areas, all those things need to be studied under a material data. And the last procedure is the operational history. Okay, so we need to say like, we need to know how long it was run. Say for example, the machine is used from so many years, means we need to say like, in a day, how many hours that component or that machine was used. Okay, and how was there any repairs and all, or a periodic maintenance, okay, any replacement of the components, okay, or any shutdown histories, okay. So lubrication methods, if there are any moving parts and all. Okay, so means whatever the things you have done for that component or a machine, okay, in a last a span of a year or a 2 year, so all those things should be checked before assessing the life of that component. So these are three methods, so by which one can assess the residual life. Okay, so if a component is replaced, so we can predict like, yes, it can withstand or it can function for a few more years, okay, depending upon the capacity of that component. Okay, or the material data which are replaced, okay, or maybe the background information, so which you're going to collect it for in order to evaluate the life of that one. So by using all these methods, so one can easily assess the remaining life of a component. Yes, so now we know the methods, so we know the procedure, but how to evaluate these things? Okay, say for example, a component is in use. I want to check the property of that component, material property. Say for example, what is the tensile strength? What is the hardness of that one? Whether that original properties are retained till today or not. Okay, so in order to have those data, we are going to have a few methods. Okay. So that is what we call as a NDT. Say for example, we want to know the erosion. Okay, erosion maybe on a turbine blades. Okay, or maybe in a pipe. Okay, so in that one. So whenever we are going to use a turbine blade or a pipes and all in which there is a flow, okay, flow of a liquid and all, we want to know the erosion of a material. Okay, so we can use the NDT method, which is called as a visual examination. Maybe say for example, by a naked eye, so one can easily identify the erosion. So if there is no proper uniform surface roughness or a surface smoothness on the turbine blades and all, okay, or ultrasonic thickness survey, say for example, if it is a pipe, you can't go inside and check the thickness or maybe erosion rate and all. So at that time we can go with the ultrasonic thickness. So if there is no uniform thickness of the wall of a pipe, okay, so we can say yes, there is a erosion. So blockade in a water circuits, we go with the fibroscopy, where we are going to insert a camera, okay, so into the pipe, and where we can detect the blockages and all. Or in order to know the welding defects, okay, so ultrasonic test or a magnetic. So what are these things, we'll see one by one. So before moving into those things, we need to know like, so what are the normal defects which are going to occur in a component which is in a use, and what are the different methods normally we employ to detect those defects. Okay, so in order to normally major in a boilers or a nuclear plants and all, okay, so where there is a joining of a components and all, so there these welding defects are common in a nature. Okay, so to detect the any defects in the welding, so we go with the ultrasonic test, magnetic test, dye penetrant test, or a radiographic test. So if it is a creep, okay, so where it is having a constant load for a long period, okay, so there we go with the in situ metallography, that is the component will be in use. So we are going to take a microstructure of that component, okay, with the help of a tape, okay, by sticking a tape, and by examining that microstructure, so one can analyze what is the condition of that material at that stage. Okay, so hardness measurement, so or else oxide scale growth ultrasonic test, where we are going to have a high intensity sound wave which is going to travel. So if there is a discontinuity, it will reflect back, and we are going to get a low intensity sound waves. Okay, so by detecting the wave of that one, so we can predict yes, there is a crack or a discontinuity in the material, or a thermal fatigue crack detection and a sizing, okay, or a short term overheating or a swelling, okay, due to the absorption of moisture or any chemical attack. So in those things, so there are plenty of methods by which we can assess the defects in the material. So by knowing the defects in the component, so one can easily assess the remaining life of a component. So in that one, the first method, so there are many, so we are going to take a few methods. So first one we say ultrasonic, as the name itself indicates, ultrasonic, okay, so means a sound wave is made to travel into the workpiece. Okay, so and the intensity at which it is reflected back from the surfaces, okay, so and if there is a discontinuity in the surface and all, so we can easily find out the exact location and the dimension of the defects which are present in the material. So just to see how it works, okay, so you can see here there is a probe. Okay, so ultrasonic transducer we say, okay, and it is connected to a monitor in which we are going to see the ECG like structures. Okay, so the intensity at which we are going to get the reflected sound waves. So the probe is moved slowly on the surface of the component, and you can see there are two waves. Okay, so one back surface signal and one we are going to have a crack echo. So if there is a, if the sound wave is not going to lead or reach to the outer surface, okay, if there is any discontinuity within the surface, okay, it will be reflected back and the intensity is red like this. So by knowing this one, so one can easily find the location, okay, and the orientation, okay, and the dimension of the crack which is present in the component. So this is without disturbing or without distracting the component. So that is what normally is the ultrasonic testing. Okay, so normally it is used to find the subsurface crack, the cracks which are present within the surfaces or beneath the surface. Okay, say for example, if it is a casting, okay, in order to find the pores, okay, or shrinkages or cavities. Okay, so for all those things we can use the ultrasonic testing. And the next method is a magnetic particle inspection. Okay, so as the name itself indicates, we are going to use a magnetic flux here, and it is restricted only for a ferrous materials, okay, or the materials which are of a magnetic in nature. So this one we can use it for a surface cracks, okay, the cracks which are present on the surface. So in order to find out the surface cracks or any discontinuity in the grinds or maybe the mixtures and all, so those things we can find out using the magnetic particle inspection. Okay, so the procedure is a simple where so you can say, so here they have showed clearly there is a crack in the surface. Okay, so initially there will be a dispersion of or a distribution of the these iron particles on the surface. Okay, you can say there is a north and south pole. Okay, if there is a cavity, okay, one end will act as a north and one end act as a south pole, and the iron particles which are spread over the surface, okay, so are going to get inserted into these crack, and then the surface is magnetized with the help of a holder, okay, magnetic holder which is connected to a electric current. By flow of that one, so surface will get and magnetized, and when we are going to magnetize the surface, okay, so there will be a attraction of these iron particles by the north and south pole of the cracks. So if there are any cracks on the surface, so these magnetic particles, sorry, these iron particles get oriented in the direction of the crack which is present in the on the surface. Okay, so then, so we can see, okay, so the by orientation of that crack, the iron particles, one can see the shape of the crack which is present on the surface. Okay, so this is one which is restricted only for a ferrous and restricted only for a surface cracks. Here you can find the the location of the crack, but it is difficult to find the depth of the crack. Okay, and the next method is a simple one, so and normally employed for all the surface crack, to detect the surface crack, is a dye penetrant inspection or a test. Okay, so normally it is used for a surface crack. So you can see it here. So initially it is cleaned, okay, to take out whatever the grease or oily particles or maybe dust particles which are present in the crack. Okay, so this is how exactly it looks. And after that one, so in order to clean this one, a cleaner, okay, is used in order to clean the surface. So it is sprayed and it is cleaned or wiped with the cotton cloths. Okay, so then a dye is used which is of having a red color. Okay, and it is sprayed over the surface. Okay, so as there is a crack, so this dye gets penetrated into the crack. Okay, so and once it is done, so the surface is cleaned again. Okay, and a developer is sprayed. A developer is sprayed. When the developer is sprayed, so what will happen? So the dye which has inserted into or penetrated into the cracker starts coming out of the crack by showing the location of the crack. Okay, you can see it here. So here it is fully cleaned over the surface, and here the developer is applied. So once the developer is applied, so the dye starts coming out of the crack. Okay. So here normally is used in order to detect the surface cracks, okay, so which are present maybe in the welding defects, okay, so pin holes or a porosity, okay, so normally it is observed or detected using a dye penetrant test. So next one will be in situ metallography. This is a very important one. You can see in the picture also, okay, so where the components are of a bigger one, okay, or a larger one or a complex one, okay. So in situ means on the site itself, okay, so which is in use, which is in use at that time itself, one can check the properties of that material. So the first figure here, the microscope is taken there itself in order to check the microstructure of the component. And in the second method, so the surface is cleaned, okay, and it is polished, and a green tape is used, and it is stuck to the surface, and it is taken out. The impressions of the microstructure are placed on this tape, and it is observed under a microscope. So whichever is convenient according to the accuracy, one can go for the different methods. Okay. So in situ, the surface needs to be studied and prepared microscopically by exam polishing and etching done in a metallographic manner. Okay. So that is what exactly we call as in situ metallography. And the last one is a visual inspection. Okay. So normally this is the first method normally we go, okay, before going with the all the remaining methods. Okay, first we are going to examine by visual inspection, that is by naked eye. Okay, so and then so if we were not able to analyze, okay, what are the defects present, so then we go with the any of the previously discussed methods. So here you can say we are going to use a magnifying glasses or a measuring instruments, okay, or a torches with the magnifying glasses in order to detect the cracks which are present on the surface. So one can easily find if there is a erosion, okay, or any degradation or any corrosion, okay, or any small cracks which are present on the surface also. Okay, so that is what normally is called as a visual examination. Means, so the first step in assessing the defects in order to, which helps to assess the residual life of a component is a visual inspection. So if you are not able to find out the defects in that one, then we choose any one of the method what we have discussed depending upon the component and the type of the defect. So if it is a surface, we go with the dye penetrant, and if it is a ferrous end surface, then we go with the magnetic particle. So if it is a subsurface, we go with the ultrasonic. So again, if it is a small component to be tested for a subsurface cracks, okay, or a casting which is should be tested for a porosity and a cracks and all, then we can go with the radiography also. Okay, so again, so it depends on the size and type of the component normally we examine. Okay, like that one can easily find out the residual life of a component. So that will be useful, very much useful in order to know the life of a component and in order to prevent the failure of a sudden failure of a component, okay, which leads to the catastrophic and a huge loss in terms of a money as well as in terms of a life. Okay, so thank you.